Part 2. About Painting. Chapter 5. Of Concerning the Spiritual in Art. By Wassily Kandinsky. Translated by Michael T. H. Sadler. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Chapter 5. The Psychological Working of Color. To let the eye stray over a palette splashed with many colors produces a dual result. In the first place, one receives a purely physical impression, one of pleasure and contentment at the varied and beautiful colors. The eye is either warmed or else soothed and cooled. But these physical sensations can only be of short duration. They are merely superficial and leave no lasting impression, for the soul is unaffected. But although the effect of the colors is forgotten when the eye is turned away, the superficial impression of varied color may be the starting point of a whole chain of related sensations. On the average man, only the impressions caused by very familiar objects will be purely superficial. A first encounter with any new phenomenon exercises immediately an impression on the soul. This is the experience of the child discovering the world, to whom every object is new. He sees a light, wishes to take hold of it, burns his finger, and feels henceforward a proper respect for flame. But later he learns that light has a friendly as well as an unfriendly side, that it drives away the darkness, makes the day longer, is essential to warmth, cooking, play-acting. From the mass of these discoveries is composed a knowledge of light, which is indelibly fixed in his mind. The strong, intensive interest disappears, and the various properties of flame are balanced against each other. In this way, the whole world becomes gradually disenchanted. It is realized that trees give shade, that horses run fast and motor cars still faster, that dogs bite, that the figure seen in a mirror is not a real human being. As the man develops, the circle of these experiences caused by different beings and objects grows ever wider. They acquire an inner meaning and eventually a spiritual harmony. It is the same with color, which makes only a momentary and superficial impression on a soul but slightly developed in sensitiveness. But even this superficial impression varies in quality. The eye is strongly attracted by light, clear colors, and still more strongly attracted by those colors which are warm as well as clear. Vermilion has the charm of flame, which has always attracted human beings. Keen lemon yellow hurts the eye in time, as a prolonged and shrill trumpet note the ear, and the gazer turns away to seek relief in blue or green. But to a more sensitive soul, the effect of colors is deeper and intensely moving. And so we come to the second main result of looking at colors, their psychic effect. They produce a corresponding spiritual vibration, and it is only as a step towards this spiritual vibration that the elementary physical impression is of importance. Whether the psychic effect of color is a direct one, as these last few lines imply, or whether it is the outcome of association, is perhaps open to question. The soul being one with the body, the former may well experience a psychic shock caused by association acting on the latter. For example, red may cause a sensation analogous to that caused by flame, because red is the color of flame. A warm red will prove exciting, another shade of red will cause pain or disgust through association with running blood. In these cases, color awakens a corresponding physical sensation which undoubtedly works upon the soul. If this were always the case, it would be easy to define by association the effects of color upon other senses than that of sight. One might say that keen yellow looks sour because it recalls the taste of a lemon. But such definitions are not universally possible. There are many examples of color working which refuse to be so classified. A Dresden doctor relates of one of his patients, whom he designates as an exceptionally sensitive person, that he could not eat a certain sauce without tasting blue, that is, without experiencing a feeling of seeing a blue color. It would be possible to suggest, by way of explanation of this, that in highly sensitive people, the way to the soul is so direct and the soul itself so impressionable that any impression of taste communicates itself immediately to the soul, and thence to the other organs of sense, in this case the eyes. This would imply an echo or reverberation, such as occurs sometimes in musical instruments, which, without being touched, sound in harmony with some other instrument struck at the moment. But not only with taste has sight been known to work in harmony. Many colors have been described as rough or sticky, others as smooth and uniform, so that one feels inclined to stroke them. For example, dark ultramarine, chromic oxide green, and rose madder. Equally, the distinction between warm and cold colors belongs to this connection. Some colors appear soft, rose madder, others hard, cobalt green, blue-green oxide, so that even fresh from the tube they seem to be dry. The expression scented colors is frequently met with. And finally, the sound of colors is so definite that it would be hard to find anyone who would try to express bright yellow in the bass notes or dark lake in the treble. The explanation by association will not suffice us in many and the most important cases. Those who have heard of chromotherapy will know that colored light can exercise very definite influences on the whole body. Attempts have been made with different colors in the treatment of various nervous ailments. They have shown that red light stimulates and excites the heart, while blue light can cause temporary paralysis. But when the experiments come to be tried on animals and even plants, the association theory falls to the ground. So one is bound to admit that the question is at present unexplored, but that color can exercise enormous influence over the body as a physical organism. No more sufficient in the psychic sphere is the theory of association. Generally speaking, color is a power which directly influences the soul. Color is the keyboard, the eyes are the hammers, the soul is the piano with many strings. The artist is the hand which plays, touching one key or another, to cause vibrations in the soul. It is evident, therefore, that color harmony must rest only on a corresponding vibration in the human soul, and this is one of the guiding principles of the inner need. End of chapter 5. Recording by Expatriate in Bangor, Maine.